Bob Hoy, editor and chief investment strategist of Institutional Advisors.
Welcome back.
Good to be with you, Chris, and also with your listeners.
Well, we appreciate that, and we'd also appreciate your thoughts today on the markets. You know, maybe we could start off with AG, a very nice futures rally in the past few days, with silver now approaching after-hours trading here in the United States. We have Labor Day, retesting the neckline of that head and shoulders breakdown from a few days ago and approaching the $20 level. That's obviously a key metric for the market.
It's been a good target. For our work a few weeks ago, the energy, the power in the rally tipped off a couple of our technical things, you know, upside exhaustions, overbought, that kind of stuff. So also to back up a bit, Chris, you'll know that, remember that back in November, we were looking for the, we used the gold divided, well, the gold shares divided by gold, and you'd want to have the gold shares starting to outperform gold. And also you'd want to have silver beginning to outperform gold for a rally, for the whole thing to bottom. And we were hoping that it would be all bottomed by, you know, late December into January. And indeed it did. And then with this bottom, we're looking for a cyclical bull market for the sector. And wow, this is what we've got with a terrific rally. But hey, it's kind of overbought. We wouldn't chase prices of either the metals or the stocks. And the silver is very important to discuss at this time because the gold-silver ratio with a rally in both metals, of course, silver will always outperform gold. And when it outperforms gold with good energy, you're getting close to the end of the rally. So what we're looking for in here is the things to go the other way, a correction for the gold and silver sector. This would be, for gold particularly, a correction within the cyclical bull market. And also the big stock market itself is kind of coming into a corner here where it could be vulnerable. LIBOR rate in the last 4 or 5 weeks has increased, and we're sort of watching that because the increase kind of looks like the increase in 2007 that preceded the problems in the credit markets, and also later on, like in April, May of 2008, when again the credit markets became a huge problem. So one of the indicators on a change in a market move is actually the gold-silver ratio itself. It can get volatile, of which it's starting to recently. The other thing is that if silver starts to underperform gold, that's a sign that the move is going to change here. So this is just looking at the gold-silver ratio here now. When things were really, everything was positive in the sector in July, the gold-silver ratio came down to 65, and now a couple of weeks ago, it got up to 72. No big move, and now it's correcting back down to the, 68 level. And one would watch for in here is some volatility in the gold-silver ratio. That would suggest that the trend in the precious metals is becoming more, or the correction we're looking for is becoming a little more closer. And then the next rise in the gold-silver ratio, if it carries beyond the last high at 72, then it becomes a warning. And then up here at the 76 level, there's resistance there on the chart, plus with the 200-day moving average. So we're watching this very closely because it's a telltale, as we like to observe, is that in the financial markets, the credit spreads and the yield curve precede the top of a rally in equities. And then also, within this, the gold-silver ratio acts like a credit spread, because in the good times, the number gets smaller, such as to a few weeks ago in July. And then in the bad times, the gold-silver ratio goes up. And so then the other thing you get, too, also when the gold-silver ratio breaks out, it can anticipate a problem in the credit market. So we've got two things going for us here now. One is that LIBOR rate has been increasing a little, but enough to get our attention. And the other thing is that the gold-silver ratio has increased a little. So any further move in these would be exciting. Now, a classic one is if a financial storm is coming, and they only come after there's been a financial party, you can come in one day and the market opens up and silver's down a huge amount, say 1.5%, and gold may not be changed too much. So that is also part and parcel of slipping into a financial storm. So that's what we're looking at here. We've had outstanding gains in the sector, particularly the stocks. We have advised now that their action has become really very overbought and that people should take a little money off the table. Now, then on the next stage, if this gold-silver ratio does break out, then it becomes a warning on the whole, all the financial markets, stocks, bonds, all that sort of stuff. So we are, Chris, in interesting times.
If we look back, let's say, at the amazing run from 05, 07 to 2011, you know, the gold-to-silver ratio was either sideways, flat, to downward, and led to explosive moves. Although silver corrected sharply, and as did the XAU, gold shares, gold has not really corrected. It's meandered within a narrow trading range, which could imply gold traders are going to be a little more stubborn as far as corrections are concerned.
Yeah, well, accounts should own some gold. That's the insurance. That's the insurance item, and you own that to kind of protect yourself, and you don't own it to make money. And the people who look to the price of gold in U.S. dollars or whatever, because you also have a problem in every post-bubble contraction, the senior currency has become chronically strong relative to most currencies and most commodities for most of the time, and it's very hard for gold people who have learned the inflation story that, hey, every time the Fed depreciates the dollar, gold's going to go up, and then you get into the condition whereby the Fed cannot depreciate the dollar. But anyways, when the rally started here coming out of January, it's fabulous, terrific, we loved it, and within a couple of months, then all of the old supply-demand, we got $7,000 gold because of zero interest rates. Somehow you can figure out that if the cost of carrying gold goes down, that's going to move it to $7,000. I don't know how you come up with these forecasts. And then other people are calling for $10,000 gold. Our view is that the dominant thing is that we are in a post-bubble contraction. The first bull market out of the crash that ended in 2009 is in stocks is more or less intact, but precarious. The first business expansion out of that crash is now getting mature and awfully tired, and the game that the central bankers have been playing was, first of all, to lower interest rates, and that would keep the boom going, but that's not clear anymore. Then they were going to buy bonds to keep the boom going, and that's pretty well in the market. And then more lately, they've been buying stocks to keep the boom going, and they have this rather quaint idea that if asset prices are up, the economy will follow. But the economy is doing what it wants to do, and they just can't get inflation, like basic commodities. Had nice rallies, seasonal rallies coming out of the basically the main pressures were on crude oil crashing down until January, and we kind of like that seasonal trade and also the rebound, but crude oil is now getting vulnerable. You want to look ahead over the shoulder of what's going on now in crude oil and say, when do you usually get the weakness? Oh, December, January. And you know what the next slide in crude oil is going to do. You've had also pretty chronic weakness in the grains. We got a brief rally out of those, smart rally, and then backed off. It looks like some of the harvests are pretty good. So it all comes down to watching A, the credit markets, and B, the gold-silver ratio, which is, I like to call it, a metallic credit spread. So here we are. If the gold-silver ratio turns up and breaks above that 72 level, it's a warning. And if it gets above 76, which is the resistance on the chart and as well from the 200-day moving average, then it would be saying that the big stock market is going to go down. And if the big stock market goes down, so will gold and silver stocks, although gold could be stable. I mean, the next financial storm that comes in, there's going to be many institutions and many people that are going to want to own some gold. And that is because it's a highly liquid item. The U.S. Treasury market is the other big place for liquidity, but it's not as liquid, especially in the longer maturities, not as liquid as it used to be. So there's more and more of a reason for liquidity seekers to fly to gold. But that doesn't mean that gold in U.S. dollar terms may go up because, as I said, in the post-bubble contraction, one of the amazing things is that the senior currency becomes consistently strong. And actually, I might put in what I think is the reason for that is because during the financial mania, of course, the big market, New York, underwrites most of the debt. And the debt, in order so that the borrowers can get a low coupon, are going to be in the senior currency units, which is the U.S. dollars. So if you have a majority of the debt in the bubble written in and due and payable in U.S. dollars, that then represents a huge short interest in dollars. And this is why the central bankers will not be able to drive the U.S. dollar down, because the whole of the world is shorted, and then you've got the dyed-in-the-wool gold bugs who hate the dollar, and they mainly hate the dollar because they hate the Fed. And I hate the Fed, too, but I'm not going to justify taking a position in gold. You have to trade gold, and you have to trade the gold shares as well, and the silver stocks, some of which became very overpriced. So on the sector, we'd take some money off the table and watch for the storm. The gold-silver ratio gets above 72, we'd take a little more money off the table and stand aside.
I'd also like your thoughts on the implications of the recent employment situation. Domestically, we have near full employment, or what would usually be considered full employment, maybe not back 10, 15 years ago, but in recent years. And with these lackluster latest jobs numbers that came in, about 100,000 fewer new jobs than anticipated, stubborn 4.9% unemployment rate seems to imply the Fed may have less wiggle room to raise rates, because I think you'd see unemployment spike for the first time, well, since the Great Recession of 2008-2009. Seems to bode well, though, for the precious metals, because, as you know, the Fed is really the only one of the trifecta, BOJ, ECB, and the Fed, to hold rates stubbornly above that zero point. Tell us how this might impact the precious metals.
The employment numbers are absolutely bogus, and I think only economists would follow them. You've got, what is it, 95 million who are not seeking work, and then they call this in down at a 5% unemployment rate. This is a scam, calculating the number. So then the next confusion out there is to assume that the Fed is actually managing interest rates. They're pushing rates down, and as are other central bankers. But within the credit markets, and this is where we rest our case, is you have the yield curve, the difference between long rates and short rates. And in any boom, they'll be borrowing short and lending long, and then eventually the squeeze comes in, and the curve will change. Typically, you have flattening with a boom, whereby long rates fall relative to short rates, although they both may be going up in previous booms. But I contend that when the yield curve reverses to steepening, seriously steepening, it tried 5 or 6 weeks ago and it didn't hold, then that's a signal. Then the other one is credit spreads, which is the difference between high-grade bonds and low-grade bonds. That's the other one. In a period of confidence, the market will reach for yield, and the risky stuff comes down in yield relative to treasuries. Now, that has been happening very, very strongly since January, when you had a terrific crash in junk bonds, and that crash was tied to the crash in crude oil. So here it all comes down to not so much what the Fed may be doing in policy, but what the financial markets will be doing to the Fed. Now, there's one other item in interest rates, and that's the real long-dated rates adjusted for inflation. In a boom, these come down, and in some cases have been negative. And this is the one, Chris, that I think sees through the nonsense of negative interest rates. When you net out inflation, then you have, and in a mania, you've got real interest rates coming down, which it has been doing. And then once this boom here and now fades, then real long interest rates will go up. So while the Fed and other central banks have been pushing long rates down in buying bonds, I don't think they have control over the yield curve. And when it turns, it becomes a warning. The other one is I don't think they have control over credit spreads. And when they turn, that'll be the warning. And then when finally real long interest rates turn and go up, then that'll be another thing. So while the world is amazed at how low rates have come down, we would look to these internal things, the curve spreads and real long interest rates, to see where financial history is really going to go. And all I know is that on a study I did years ago in staying with the senior central bank, which used to be the Bank of England, and they've been able to really move interest rates around to follow the market since about the Bank Revision Act, or whatever they called it, in the 1840s. So you've had bubbles since. And on the observation is that going into a boom when rates would go up and going into the bust when rates would go down, the senior central bank has been 3 or 4 months behind the change in market rates of interest. So this is where I tell people now who are all concerned about what the Fed is going to do, don't bother. Just waste the time, because whatever they do, they'll be behind the change in market rates of interest anyway. So this end, you come back to looking at the curve spreads and real interest rates. I don't think the Fed research guys are watching real interest all that closely. As a matter of fact, I think that the Fed, who knows, they got 300 economists, and they're all working on models. Models don't work in the financial markets when you're in a period of great speculation. So in answer to what the Fed's going to do, there's no point talking about it, because they'll be behind the event when it happens.
Most of the models, as you mentioned, are linear-based, and, of course, chaotic systems do not follow linear paths.
Well, what it is, when you're in speculative move, and we did some work on this back in the 70s, it's called a skewed growth curve. And when we did the work then, there was no proof that you could not solve skewed curves. But at any rate, nobody, I think, has yet been able to solve skewed growth curves. But what you have is that those skewed curves are all the same. So if you take a look at the daily chart on the South Sea Company in 1720, and then you move ahead to the daily chart on Radio Corp of America, RCA, in 1929, and then you jump ahead to 2000 and take a look at, say, something, a big company like Cisco, it's all the same chart. So while a computer can't solve the curve on a skewed growth curve, an analog model where you overlay it can. And so we're in a world of skewed growth curves, which will confound any econometric model. They just don't work. We've found things to work is when you have the historical pattern on how a bubble blows out, what's associated with it, like the yield curve and credit spreads and real interest rates, then you've got something that at least looks rational. Whereas if you're a policymaker, these guys are looking out and they're thinking this thing is totally irrational. Because first of all, a little easing was supposed to make the economy go up. That wasn't working. Then a lot of easing was supposed to make it go up. That's not working. And then they started QE, and that's not working. And then now they're buying stocks, and we'll soon see whether that works or not, but I doubt it. And what it is, they're trying to impose an arbitrary view on what is a huge global market. So I think it's been a dreadful experiment, founded upon inadequate research. And I like to point out that if one has had a thorough read of financial history, you would never, ever derive a theory of intervention whereby you think you can change financial history. But those that do come up with theories about arbitrary intervention haven't read financial history. So it's absurd that and they're pushing against financial history. And every time on these ones, the financial history soon instructs the theorists. But in the meantime, society has to go through a lot of nonsense because markets, if they were totally private, can become highly speculative. Because if we go back in England, when the central bank was responsible and on a gold standard, you had huge financial bubbles, 1873, 1929, for example, 1825, and crashes. The policymakers didn't create the bubble and didn't create the crash. It's all natural. So what you have here now is that the private sector can get fully speculative in a mania all on its own. But what you have had now is a theory that a gifted committee can manage the economy, and more or less really focus with the introduction of the Federal Reserve in 1913. This, first of all, the theory of intervention is highly speculative. A guy just dreamt it up, Keynes, for example. But at any rate, what you have now is that they've taken a speculative theory and are pushing it with highly reckless activities and on top of a market where the public is very willing to speculate. So you've had boom and bust when the central bank was neutral, and you've had now, particularly recently, booms and busts when the central banks were trying to make sure that the boom always goes up. So when this one lets loose, I think the next contraction in the economy and bear market, fully observable bear market in stocks, the public's going to say, hey, look at central bankers. We're going to take over money again. They'll go for a gold standard. And it's the same as the political movement developing now to get rid of the experts in general politics and government and let the and put the responsibility and accountability back into the public, into the voters' hands. I've been calling it the American Spring. I hope it's successful.
Okay, so give us an idea then about this interesting story that broke last week regarding Deutsche Bank, one of Europe's top banking institutions, which is struggling with huge bad derivatives bets lately, refused to deliver sizable bullion, gold bullion, on hand to a client. Caused an uproar within the industry, but nothing seems to really indicate there was any solid evidence that gold bullion should not have been delivered to its rightful owner. That seems to go right in line with many of the central banks demanding their gold repatriation.
They couldn't deliver. I don't know why. Maybe their just accounts are so screwed up, they're so leveraged that they just couldn't do it, which is concerning. Also, even separate from this supposed delivery problem, is that Deutsche Bank is in deep doo-doo anyways, because, as you said, they've been running the big derivatives book. And you take a look at the stock, and it's been heading south hugely until you had the Brexit crisis in June, and then everything's bounced back. And, you know, looking over your shoulder and during that crisis, I mean, it was a really good clear-out. Easy to look over your shoulder and say afterwards, oh, yeah, which has been happening, but the central bankers have no special wisdom. Maybe at one time the Federal Reserve had privileged information on certain economic series or financial conditions, but they don't have any more. I mean, the big firms have got all the information, and then you don't even have to be within a big firm to figure out what's going on, because if you've got good technical research and methods, you can tell when it's overbought and oversold, so you don't have to have privileged information. And so this one about a delivery problem, somewhere the truth of this matter will probably come out. But, of course, all of the supply-demand analysis got onto it and said there's a shortage of gold, therefore, you know, 5,000 to 10,000 gold. But you cannot rationally forecast that gold's going to go to $3,000 or $5,000 on a crisis. What you can do is analyze previous bubbles and busts and understand that in a boom such as we've had recently, the real price of gold goes down, which it has done, adjusted by the producer price index or CPI. And that was the case in 1929 as well, 1873, all of these bubbles. You had the real price of gold coming down to an important low as the bubble blew out, and then the real price goes up, and that then improves the operating margins for gold miners. And like, for example, in 1929, in U.S. terms, the price of gold was fixed at $20.67 an ounce, and in 1929, Homestake, the premier producer, lost money or didn't make money because the costs of mining were going up. And then after the bust, sure, their stock was taken down on the bust, but then because of the problems in base metal sector, mining equipment and mining supplies and mining wages became a whole lot easier, Homestake's earnings went up. They went up hugely. That was in 1932, before Roosevelt started fiddling around with the price of gold in 1933. So there, if I recall rightly, their earnings were up something like 130%, as was the stock. And the price of gold stayed the same, $20.67 an ounce. And then also at the time, venture became a big producer in Canada, which was Dome Mines. And the same thing held for them. So this is where I try and caution supply-demand analysis on gold or silver is because it doesn't work. And what you're interested in is the real price and whether profitability is coming into the gold mining or not. And the real price, as deflated by the PPI, is coming up. And eventually it will be improve operating margins. And I think the reason, Chris, why it's Mother Nature runs the show, you know, and you've had an unbelievable expansion in credit, in the normal instruments of credit. You've also had the Wall Street inventing all kinds of abnormal instruments of credit, of which Deutsche Bank is a participant. And then when the game is over, then that contracts and the liquidity disappears. But underneath it all, the banking system needs liquidity. And the only way you can get that is in gold. So then as the gold's real price goes up, production increases. And despite all the Keynesians out there, that gold will get into the banking system and it starts to refresh it, rebuild it. And if you look back on all of the six great bubbles, beginning with the first one in 1720, and it works every time, then you have a very reliable method of which the way the financial history works. So our reason for the cyclical bull market in gold is because you're now getting a very good recovery in gold's real price, and it'll make the business very profitable. And indeed, on each of the post-bubble contractions, the one sector that is predictably that you can predict that'll do well will be the gold sector. And in each case, four out of the five Great Depressions, the real price of gold went up by the same amount each time, 1.7 times the low on annual averages. So who needs a forecast of $10,000 gold price, which may not work out? It's just a guess anyways, when history suggests that the real price is going to go up enough to make the gold sector the most exciting place in town. That's all you need to know, Chris, is that the gold sector is going to become the big game in town. That's good news.
You also seem to be throwing out this idea that this rally could fizzle.
For the gold and silver stocks, yeah, it became hugely overbought, triggered off a number of our upside exhaustions and patterns and stuff. So the sector is overbought and will correct just on that analysis. And you know it'll correct if the bottom falls out of the New York Stock Exchange. And at the same time, there could be quite an increase in investment demand for gold. I have no problem with that. But if you've got liquidity problems in the whole stock market, you're going to have downward pressures on the gold and silver stocks.
You feel that it's then not really prudent to be making calls of 5 to 10,000 on gold, despite some of these fundamental factors that many guests on this show have brought up in the past?
Well, because it's irrational. There's no way that you can do a sound analysis and come up with a $5,000 or $10,000 forecast for gold. But what you can do is take a look at financial history and realize that the real price of gold could double. And the industry is going to get as exciting as you could imagine. But I feel uncomfortable for these guys who are coming up with these $10,000 forecasts. I mean, even last year, Pierre Lassonde, who I've known since when he was back as a money manager, took a look at the zero interest rate and said, hey, gold's going to go to 7,000. There's no way. Those are just guesses. But if you've looked at history and you see four of the Great Depressions where the price on annual averages increased by 1.7 times, then you got a working pattern. And so that's on annual averages. So if you take it from the worst mid-year and then at the best on when we get there, the real price of gold will probably double. And you know what that's going to do to profit margin.
Give us a better idea, though, because when you start talking about a depression, there is some evidence of that. If we take John Williams' numbers at Shadow Stats, we've never really recovered in the last 15 years. It's been sort of stuck in an economic morass for almost a decade and a half. However, if we look at the official numbers, it seems to indicate everything's fine. And, you know, the stock market doesn't care about official numbers. The stock market cares about people being employed, spending money, thus corporate profits, higher share prices. I'm sure there's the listener out there thinking to themselves, wait a minute, you know, what depression is Bob Hoy talking about?
In 2007, you had all the features of a great bubble such as 1929 or 1873. And then you had the crash, which they called the worst recession and worst crash since the 1930s. It's on schedule. Then you had the first business expansion out of the first crash and the first bull market both of which are now precarious. So it's like 1937 or 38 that you have that huge rebound in stocks, but that was mainly because the S&P gave up 87%. Now, in the 1929 crash in London, which was the senior economy and the senior financial market, their stock index fell in half. But by the time you get to 2007, New York is the senior stock market, and guess what? It fell 48 or 49%, same as London did in 1929. So you've had the first hit. Now we're the first economic expansion, and it's mature, and the stock market is mature, so we're looking for the next cyclical bear market in stocks. We're going to have another recession come in if it hasn't started already. So this is the thing about all of these great depressions in the past, is that the usual four or five-year business cycle continued, but you just netted out as a long contraction. In England, it definitely was the 1929 to, you know, well, actually, if you look at the credit market, the contraction ran until you had the low for interest rates, which was 1946. So the contraction ran from 1929 to 1946. Now, the previous one was 1873 to 1895. And on the final business, that final recession in 1895, that cleared out all of the problems in the credit markets, and then it was set up for a long dynamic expansion. So these things are fairly regular, and despite a massive attempt to alter financial history, you're still in a period of booms and busts. As I said earlier in our discussion here, that in the next 4 or 5 weeks, the internal credit markets will tell us what's really happening, and that's the curve spreads and real long interest rates.
We like to promote a portfolio approach to investing here on the show, and I wonder if you then could give folks an idea on whether or not you'd be increasing the weighting of the precious metals and or shares and or bonds. Give us the perfect portfolio melange.
Okay, now, this is for, say, a fixed income. You want to go to 3 to 4 year U.S. treasuries, sorry, U.S. prime corporates, you know, AAA stuff or double A's, because you'll get a slightly better yield than out of the Treasury market. And being out at 3 or 4 years, or let's just say 4 years maturity, you're going to get your money back at that time, no matter what financial storm goes on. That's a safe place where you'll get a better return and with risk considered. Elsewhere, on the big stock market, you've had the hottest games. There's a big computer stock registered upside exhaustions. A few weeks, you've had the utilities do the same thing. You had the base metal sector do the same thing, and you had all our technical stuff on the gold stocks. So you've reached some climaxes on these things, and we're going to get a correction in the precious metals, and quite likely a bear market in the big New York Stock Exchange, because what got us on the topping market last year was, for the first time, we used the old Dow theory, and we were impressed with how long the Dow was going up when the transports were not confirming. And then you had the failure in May, and that was it. We said the Dow theory says that the bull market's over. And then in July, our work on the bank stocks said that they were now vulnerable, and that's where we came out with our comment that bank stocks, most bank stocks, were a nice widows and orphans short. We had upside exhaustions on the Shanghai market. We needed one more set of upside exhaustions to conclude that mania, which came in June, and then it all went south. So what we have here now, this time, the hottest sectors, such as the utilities, base metals, and the gold stocks, gave us huge upside exhaustion signals some weeks ago. So the leadership on the big stock market has been exciting, but the best is in for those. And so it all looks crisp, very vulnerable. And one more jump up, for example, in LIBOR rate could really do it. And again, when we did this work on LIBOR, we pointed out that it precedes any move by the senior central bankers to raise rates.
Bob Hoy, we appreciate your thoughts today, and I wonder if you would please tell folks more about institutional advisors and the services you provide, any contact information you'd like to leave today.
Sure thing. Yeah, we cover the whole spectrum in the financial markets, as our listeners would note. And you can get in touch with us. You can just Google my name, Bob Hoy, B-O-B-H-O-Y-E, and it all comes up, or institutionaladvisors.com. And we have a trial introduction. You just get the same as what everybody gets for 4 or 5 weeks. If you like it, come on. If you don't, that's fine, too.
Very good. Thank you, Bob Hoy.
Anytime, Chris. Look forward to the next one.
The gold and silver mining sector is red hot. Every investment portfolio needs precious metal shares. GoldSeek.com's top stock analysts have done it again, identifying the next solid gold nugget opportunity, Brazil Resources. Based in the 8th largest economy with a mining-friendly reputation, almost 10 million ounces of gold reserves, industry insiders are accumulating shares of Brazil Resources. The notable management team includes Chairman Amir Adnani, a rising star in the mining industry with a reputation for moving projects rapidly into production. Fortune magazine lists Chairman Adnani in the prestigious list of 40 under 40 ones to watch. Plus, shareholders benefit from the insights and backing of enigmatic Brazilian billionaire Mario Garneiro, CEO of Brazil Invest Group, the nation's foremost merchant and investment bank, and founding director. Their São Jorge project is 100% owned with paved highway access, a nearby workforce, and a hydroelectric power source near the major gold deposits. Their next top project includes 3 deposits identified by major gold producers, plus their RIA project, which is a joint venture with Areva, benefits from a $10 million treasure map in the hottest address for uranium production in Canada. But the story gets even more exciting with their Whistler project, offering geographic diversification in South Central Alaska. To find out more about this unique opportunity, please direct your web browsers to BrazilResources.com. At Yahoo Finance, ticker symbol BRI.V. Remember, to ride the exciting gold stock run of 2016 and beyond, your portfolio will thank you for adding shares of Brazil Resources.
GoldSeek employees may or may not own shares. Nothing contained herein should be construed as investment advice.